The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. O God, whose blessed Son did manifest himself to his disciples in the breaking of bread, open, we pray thee, the eyes of our faith, that we may behold him in all his redeeming work. Through the same thy Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. And when Peter saw it, he addressed the people, "Men of Israel, why do you wonder at this, or why do you stare at us, as though by our own power or piety we had made him walk? The God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob, the God of our fathers, glorified his servant Jesus, whom you delivered up and denied in the presence of Pilate, when he had decided to release him. But you denied the Holy and Righteous One and asked for a murderer to be granted to you and killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses. And his name, by faith in his name, has made this man strong, whom you see and know. And the faith which is through Jesus has given this man this perfect health in the presence of you all. And now, brethren, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did your rulers, but what God foretold by the mouth of all the prophets, that his Christ should suffer, he thus fulfilled. Repent, therefore, and turn again, that your sins may be blotted out, that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord." The word of the Lord.
Thank you. A reading from the first letter of John. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God. And so we are. The reason why the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. It does not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And everyone who thus hopes in him purifies himself as he is pure. Everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he appeared to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one abides in him sins. No one who sins has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. He who does right is righteous, as he is righteous. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Pray, Father, a blessing. The Lord be with you.
And with
my spirit. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke.
Glory to you,
O Lord. Jesus himself stood among them. But they were startled and frightened, and supposed that they saw a spirit. And he said to them, "Why are you troubled, and why do questionings rise in your hearts? See my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Handle me and see, for a spirit has not flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And while they still disbelieved for joy and wondered, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it before them. Then he said to them, "These are my words which I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures and said to them, "Thus it is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins should be preached in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem." You are witnesses of these things. The Gospel of the Lord.
They still disbelieved for joy. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. According to the app on my phone, today's forecast is 81 degrees and not a cloud in the sky. And from my vantage point, looking through the windows, so far that seems to be the case. Warming to a beautiful 81. And I can't see a cloud in the sky. Now, if you were to ask me, I would say today is going to be a beautiful day. But what makes it beautiful? Aside from the warm sun on your skin, and the gentle breeze, and the cloudless sky, what actually makes it beautiful? This afternoon, in this beautiful day, Cheryl and I are going to the Winston-Salem Symphony to hear Beethoven. And I imagine on our ride home, we will say to each other, that was beautiful. But what makes it beautiful? Aside from the genius of Beethoven and his choice of notes, aside from the brilliance of the conductor or the construction and quality of the instruments, the skill of the musicians and the singers, what makes it beautiful? There was a polymath in the 15th century who's now become my new hero named Leon Battista. What's his last name? Leon Battista Alberti. He's my hero. I just can't remember his name. He forgot nothing. He was a poet. He was a linguist. He was an artist. He was an architect. And if I wasn't feeling bad enough today, he was also a priest. He fit all those things into his life. He spent a lot of time thinking about beauty and writing about beauty, and his definition of beauty was something along the lines of, beauty is the harmony of all the parts of the whole, so that if you added something or took something away, it would be for the worse. Beauty is the harmony of all the parts in the whole, that if you added something or took something away, it would be for the worse. What does that mean? Well, I think what he means is we understand proportion and harmony and all those things, but it's not a satisfactory definition because where is the line? I mean, for instance, I think personally that if you were to give me a good tan, a head full of hair, veneers and laser eye surgery and suck away 15 pounds, I would look a lot better. But at a certain point, you cross a line. And I think we all can relate to seeing maybe some celebrity that maybe we remember from 20 or 30 years ago, and they have done some things to stop the passage of time. And all the things that were added, we might say, they don't look nearly as good as they would if they just simply let aging happen naturally. So that definition, while it makes some sense, doesn't work in all cases. The classic definitions of beauty, I think, also are problematic. What did Plato say? Plato, I think he said that something is beautiful when it corresponds more closely to the ideal form of what that object should be. A tree is beautiful when it best corresponds to the ideal form of a tree, whatever that might mean. Even Thomas Aquinas, whom I love, said that beauty has three things in it. It has perfection, proportion, and clarity. Now, that makes sense if you're buying a diamond ring. Because you want it to be perfect. You don't want a crack in it. It needs to have proportion and harmony. I mean, you can buy a 9-carat ring. You can buy the Hope Diamond. But if you put it on a delicate finger, it wouldn't be beautiful. It'd be gaudy. And then clarity, so that when you see it, it would dazzle. All those things make sense. But can you use Aquinas' definition for the day? Can you use that mathematical formula to understand the beauty of the Moonlight Sonata? Can you use that to understand why we fall in love with a face or a laughter or a smile or an intellect or a personality? I don't think so. There is one definition of beauty, though, that I think works, and it's by a contemporary theologian in Greece who said this. Beauty charms. Beauty charms so that it stirs within a person a desire to be in relationship. So I think this day is beautiful, 81, cloudless. And that moves something within me to want to be out in it, to not hide away inside, but to enjoy it, to feel the warmth, to feel the breeze, to hear the birds who are also enjoying this day. I think it works with Beethoven. When I hear that composition, it stirs within me a desire to want to be immersed in the music and to hear more and to learn more about it, to learn about the composer and the complexity and to expand my knowledge of all that he has composed. It works with people. If I am charmed, something inside of me is stirred to want to be in relationship with you because of your face, because of your personality, because of your kindness. I'm charmed. In today's gospel, we're now in St. Luke. And for the past 2 weeks, we've been in John's gospel. And today, we pick up back on the day of the resurrection. And Luke's gospel is very similar in many ways to John's gospel when it comes to the resurrection. I mean, there's some things that they have in common. For instance, they both have Mary Magdalene as the first at the tomb to see that it is empty, although Luke adds Joanna and another Mary there. Luke adds some other details. He says that Jesus appeared to two disciples who were walking on their way to Emmaus. Luke doesn't tell us who they are, but tradition says it's Cleopas and St. Luke himself, which may be why St. Luke does not mention their names. St. Luke also gives a very short reference to Jesus having a one-off resurrection appearance to Simon Peter, who St. Paul also confirms in 1 Corinthians 15. But in today's gospel, where we are, we're at the evening of the day of the resurrection. We're on the evening of Easter Day, where Jesus for the first time appears to the 11. Remember, Judas is now gone. And Jesus appears to his disciples and stands before them, and they are understandably terrified, thinking they're looking at a ghost. And Jesus says to them, "Why are you troubled? And why do questionings rise in your hearts? See my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Handle me and see, for a spirit has not flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And this, I think, is a most curious turn of phrase from St. Luke. "And while they still disbelieved for joy." What on earth does that mean? They still disbelieved for joy. I believe it means that these disciples, when they saw the risen Lord, were overwhelmed with joy, of excitement, of seeing Jesus Christ in their midst, not a specter, not a ghost, not a spirit, but Jesus of Nazareth, crucified and now risen. Yet they did not understand what they were looking at. They could not comprehend it. It did not make sense. And as they were trying to connect all the dots and put all the pieces together, they kept coming up short. Yet they had joy. And the thing is, when you read in the Gospels, when Jesus appears to anyone, that is exactly what happens. Joy comes first. Joy is there along with confusion and lack of understanding and not being able to connect the dots. But joy always comes first. And then what Jesus does after that appearance is that then patiently, lovingly, mercifully, he helps them to understand the meaning of their joy. And we see that today. After he says all this to them, they give him a piece of broiled fish, and some old manuscripts even say a honeycomb. And he gives it to them because he asks for food, not because he was hungry, but to show them, I am real. And then once he does that, St. Luke tells us, he then opens the scriptures to them to explain what all this means and how all of Holy Writ had looked for this great revelation of God in Jesus Christ and the redemption and restoration of all things. Joy comes first, and then understanding. That's how it is in the Gospels. But if that's how it is in the Gospels, why do we in our modern time try so very hard to flip that order? Why is there this expectation among people of faith that first you must have it all figured out and understand it and know all the information before joy is possible? I mean, the reason why is because that's how everything else in our life is ordered. You've got to figure it out. You've got to understand. And in our information age, it's so much easier to do that. And people of goodwill and an earnest desire to know more, when they come to me pastorally and they want to know this joy, oftentimes what they ask is, what book can I read? What article can I look at? What podcast can I listen to? But that's not the way it works. We have to be charmed. We have to encounter the beauty of faith, to have something within us stirred that moves us to turn toward relationship, to be surprised, to not be in control, to be overwhelmed, to know joy. One of my favorite verses in all of Holy Scripture comes from Jeremiah, the 20th chapter, verse 7. And in one archaic translation, Jeremiah says to God after his call, "You seduced me, Lord, and I have been seduced." A modern, more tame version that you might find in your Bible says, "You enticed me, Lord, and I was enticed." There's no deception there. But once we are charmed by the beauty of the Lord, the beauty of holiness, the beauty of a full and fulfilled life, it shocks us. It turns everything we know up on end, and we are joyfully and wonderfully submissive to the will of the Holy Spirit. To know joy is to be open to beauty. And the point I want to make is that beauty is not an aesthetic choice that someone makes. Beauty is not superfluous ornamentation or something else. It is a theological statement. And if beauty is that which charms someone into relationship, ugliness is the opposite. It's what moves us away from relationship. And I would argue, and I think you'll agree, if that is the definition of ugliness, there's a lot of it in the world. What does the world need? The power of beauty. Not to tell you, not to instruct you, but to invite you. The beauty of holiness is to present a rhythm of life rooted in prayer, one that is full of love and grace and mercy, one that is infectious once we see it. This place is beautiful because it invites us in to get lost, to bring all of our anxieties, all of our questions, all of our doubts, all of our happiness, and let it reverberate in the very structure of this place. The music calls us to a different kind of experience. gives us a different kind of language, along with the liturgical language that we use. The sights, the sounds, the people who are here are all involved in this wonderful invitation of beauty, so that we may be stirred to be in relationship with the Lord Jesus, not having it all figured out, not having all the answers, but to prioritize what should come first: joy. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Ghost of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Lord and giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spake by the prophets. And I believe one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. My brothers and sisters, as we kneel together in prayer this morning, let us pray for our parish, our community, and for the world. We continue to pray for peace, especially in the Holy Land and in the Middle East, for an end of all violence and war. We pray for those on our parish prayer list, for Mary Anicelli, Joe Potter, Ronnie Petroni, Eileen Bowman, Beth McLean, Krista Mullis, Matty Sherrod, Chris Lapeer, Judy Hicks, Kathleen Zarodka, Kate Drown, John Horn, Catherine and Charles, Mark Chambers, Jim Statton, Bill Primo, Steve Ridgel, William Reeves, Lou Hall, and Tom Manns. Today we pray for Mary Elizabeth Craig on the anniversary of her baptism. And we pray for those who have died, praying for the repose of the souls of Chuck DeVito, Debbie Shelton, and on his year's mind, Luther Conrad. Rest eternal grant unto them, O Lord, and let light perpetual shine upon them. May their soul and the souls of all the faithful departed through the mercy of God rest in peace. Amen. With these and all our petitions, let us pray for the whole state of Christ Church and the world. Almighty and ever-living God, who in thy holy word hast taught us to make prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all men, receive these our prayers, which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord. And grant that all those who do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and other ministers, that they may, both by their life and doctrine, set forth thy true and lively word and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. And to all thy people, give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that, with meek heart and due reverence, they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. We beseech thee also so to rule the hearts of those who bear the authority of government, and this in every land, that they may be led to wise decisions and right actions for the welfare and peace of the world. Open, O Lord, the eyes of all people, to behold thy gracious hand in all thy works, that, rejoicing in thy whole creation, they may honor thee with their substance and be faithful stewards of thy bounty. And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor all those who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear, beseeching thee to grant them continual growth in thy love and service, and to grant us grace, so to follow the good examples of the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, Saint Timothy, and of all thy saints, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant these our prayers, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate. Amen. Ye who do truly and earnestly repent you of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbor, and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith and take this holy sacrament to your comfort and make your humble confession to Almighty God, devoutly kneeling. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed, by thought, word, and deed, against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent, and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us. The burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Your comfortable words our Lord Jesus Christ saith to all who truly turn to him, come unto me, all ye that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. For God so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten Son, to the end that all who believe in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Here also what St. Paul said, this is a true saying and worthy of all men to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Here also what St. John said, if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray.
And I will lift up my hands in thy name.
We offer the sacrifice of the Mass to the glory of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, with special intention for peace in the Holy Land. Pray that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Father Almighty. May the Lord receive this sacrifice at my hands to the praise and glory of his name, to our benefit and to that of all his holy church. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks unto our Lord God. It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, everlasting God. But chiefly are we bound to praise thee for the glorious resurrection of thy Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is the very Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and hath taken away the sin of the world, who by his death hath destroyed death, and by his rising to new life again hath won for us everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, O glory be to thee, Almighty God, for that thou of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there by his one oblation of himself once offered a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute, and in his holy gospel command us to continue, a perpetual memory of that his precious death and sacrifice, until his coming again. For in the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it in remembrance of me." Wherefore, O Lord and Heavenly Father, according to the institution of thy dearly beloved Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, we thy humble servants do celebrate and make here before thy divine majesty, with these thy holy gifts which we now offer unto thee, the memorial thy Son hath commanded us to make, having in remembrance his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, rendering unto thee most hearty thanks for the innumerable benefits procured unto us by the same. And we most humbly beseech thee, O merciful Father, to hear us, and of thy almighty goodness vouchsafe to bless and sanctify with thy word and Holy Spirit these thy gifts and creatures of bread and wine, that we, receiving them according to thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ's holy institution, and remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. And we earnestly desire thy fatherly goodness, mercifully to accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that, by the merits and death of thy Son Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee that we and all others who shall be partakers of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ, be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him. And although we are unworthy through our manifold sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord. By whom and with whom in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee. O Father Almighty, world without end,
amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ hath taught us, we are bold to say,
"Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven."
The peace of the Lord be always with you. We do not presume to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under thy table, but thou art the same Lord, whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who taketh away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we most heartily thank thee for that thou dost feed us in these holy mysteries with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and dost assure us thereby of thy favor and goodness towards us, and that we are very members in corporate and the mystical body of thy Son, the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of thy everlasting kingdom. And we humbly beseech thee, O heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen.
Alleluia, Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia. Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to St. Timothy's on this third Sunday of Easter. So good to see all of you. If you're visiting with us, welcome to our parish. I am Father Steve Rice. I'm the rector. Father Luke Klingstead, our curate. For those who've been here for a while know our tradition is we say our prayers in the sacristy once this is over, and then Father Luke and I start here to greet folks, and then we make our way to Glass after Mass. Hope to see you either here or there. I think we have mimosas today for Glass after Mass. $3 if you want a mimosa. Everything else is on the house. Some announcements concerning this parish. Today evening prayer and benediction at 5 p.m. And then the schedule is as normal. And all that information is there in your notices. Thank you for being here to lean into this theological statement that a life of faith is a life of beauty, and for supporting our commitment in this parish of promoting beauty and what we do, but most importantly, in who we are as we live deeper and deeper into the life of Jesus Christ.
Speaking of support, on the back of the notices, there's a letter that went out to everyone who pledged last year, but Father Steve and I reprinted it in the notices in case you did not. But we sent out our quarterly statements, first quarter, and pretty much every year, except for this year, we expect to be in the red. People kind of fall behind and then they catch up, especially, you know, when the year ends. Usually that's when people fulfill their pledges. But because of your faithfulness, people are on top of it. And we have a number in the black for the first quarter. So thank you very much for staying on top of your pledge, if you pledge. If you just give a loose plate, thank you also for your generosity. But that is encouraging for us to kind of breathe a sigh of relief and not feel like we're climbing out of a hole after the first quarter. So thank you very much for that. Thank you for your commitment to this parish and to the work we do. A couple quick formation announcements. The young adults have our every other week gathering today. After evening prayer and benediction, we'll go out to dinner somewhere in the city. And then the youth have their normal youth schedule with the addition of a service project. We're serving dinner at the Ardmore Methodist Food Bank this Thursday. So a reminder about that. Again, it's good to see everyone. We'd love to greet you here or in ECW. Please kneel for the blessing. The Lord be with you. The blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you now and forever.
Amen. Depart in peace.
The Lord be with you.
With thy spirit.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. The same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Thanks be to God. Rejoice and be glad, O Virgin Mary, Alleluia.
For the Lord is indeed,
Alleluia. Let us pray. O God, who by the resurrection of thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, hast brought joy to the whole world, grant that through his mother, the Virgin Mary, we may obtain the joys of life everlasting, through Jesus Christ our Lord.